Hi, I'm Jenny Brockie. Tonight on Insight, how some people manage to divorce well.
Jeremy and I would just be in tears because it was awful. We were so sad about what had happened.
How did you react to the agreement?
Originally, I was really angry.
Really?
It said stupid things like, I will not feed my child McDonald's.
One of the rules was there was no sleepovers in the family home. You could do whatever you wanted to do in the apartment, just leave it clean when we get back.
So you're getting under one another's skin for years. Mm. When did things start to change?
Probably when that partner left the scene.
Welcome, everyone. Good to have you with us tonight. Billy, it's 15 years since you and your ex-wife, Elisa, here divorced. How do you get on now?
I would say we're friends. So it's taken some time, but we're at a stage now where we have a son together, so we co-parent and we do that well. But we've also got to a point where we talk about things besides just our son now.
And Elisa, when you and Billy were divorcing, could you have imagined sitting here now saying you're friends?
No, it's not something that I contemplated, but I'm really thankful for. Mm.
Why wouldn't you have ever contemplated it?
Because it was such a tough breakup. And there was so much hurt, anger and pain that we both went through.
You were 23 when you married Billy. You already had a five-year-old daughter, which you brought to the relationship. What was the marriage like?
We had our issues, but there was no real high drama that we had to go through.
Yeah.
Maybe, like, you disagree with that?
No. I mean, obviously, we had challenges, but we were only married for 2 years and we're together for five. So the 2 years actually went by quite quickly.
And Billy, you ended the marriage after those 2 years. What was going on for you at the time?
I'd like to just use the excuse that I was young, but I was very emotionally immature. So when we started to have some challenges in the relationship, for me, the easiest way to deal with that was to just step back and try to emotionally insulate myself from those challenges. I think that Elisa was a little bit blindsided. We're going through the typical up and down of a relationship. I kept that up and down a relationship going whilst in the background I was planning for separation. So that made it an easy separation for me in the sense where I knew exactly what was happening. The difficult part for me was building up the courage to actually talk to Elisa and say, I'm done, I'm walking away.
And Elisa, you reacted very strongly to that. Why did you react so strongly to what Billy did?
Well, I think first and foremost it was rejection. And I didn't handle that well. Coming from a broken family, getting married was my ultimate goal. So to have that loss was quite devastating. I reacted badly. I was aggressive.
How?
I remember kicking Billy in the shins and trying to punch him in the face one day just to release some anger. And also used words a lot. So, yeah, it came out in negative ways. Mm.
And for a while you talked through a diary. Can you explain how that worked?
So Calvin was three and he was going to childcare and I would write in the diary about maybe if he'd been unwell or if I've got plans on a certain day and could I have him an extra day and those types of communications.
Was this because you couldn't talk to one another?
Yeah, and so Billy would pick him up and then read the diary and then converse with me through the diary.
How long did that go on for?
It would be at least 12 months. So the conversations we were having leading up to the diary were quite aggressive.
Yeah.
And the diary did start off a little bit that I would get ranty stories. The abuse continued through the diary, but that was fine. We had the agreement that I would acknowledge and respond, and it slowly transitioned to where it was about Calvin. And that was almost the trigger where we were able to start talking a little bit again as well. So the diary was great to allow us to communicate when we couldn't actually verbally communicate.
Michael, you'd been married to Fiona for 21 years when you called an end to your marriage. Why?
I think that for a long time in the marriage, I was more focused on trying to be confident about being financially secure. And then once I felt that had settled, I was wanting to engage more with Fiona, and we had difficulty trying to re-establish what we'd had before children. And as I was pursuing, she was, I felt, rejecting me more and more. And we just couldn't seem to sort it out.
Had you tried counselling?
We had tried counselling and it didn't work. And that then gave me the clarity that I couldn't see a way forward.
Fiona, why do you think you split?
I think we grew apart. I think our interests became quite different. I did a lot of volunteering and I think I felt that Michael didn't really value that and didn't really understand why I wanted to do that.
Was it a shock to you when Michael said he wanted to end the marriage?
Not really. I think for a long time we'd been sort of living separately inside the marriage. Mm.
Dan, you were about 17 when your parents separated.
Yes, I was.
How were they getting on in the lead up to the separation from your point of view?
Yeah, so in the months, I guess, leading up to that moment where it was finally called a quits, for me, there was a lot of verbal aggression. There was just a lot of yelling and fighting and screaming at it.
Emma, you were 16, going into your final year of school when all this happened. Mm. How did you react to hearing they were separating?
I think that throughout the entire house, we could feel that tension building, and so I think I felt a sense of relief when we were told that things were hopefully going to change.
Mm. And Madeline, what about you? You were only 11. Do you remember the thoughts that went through your mind when you heard?
I just remember being like, I'm not really understanding where this had come from, and then I remember just like, this can't be happening, this isn't real. And then very quickly it was real. Yeah. Mm.
Fiona, you suggested getting a lawyer initially. Why?
Did I? Mm. I don't remember that.
Yeah, no,
I actually do remember that.
No, what happened was that...
sorry, I may be
I don't remember that.
My memory of it was that this was right at the very beginning, that you said, well, we'll have to organise lawyers. And I said, what do we need lawyers for? Like, if we'll just split things 50-50. And if you want more, well, then you can have the whole lot and you can explain to the kids why I'm out in the street. And then you immediately backed off and said, that's stupid. And from then on, it never got raised again.
OK. I don't remember that conversation.
I think he must have kept a diary.
Maybe I should have kept a diary.
Do you remember how you were feeling at this time, Fiona?
I think we moved on very quickly to the practicalities. I still had to keep the house running and the cooking and the cleaning and the looking after the kids. So it was still very much along those practical lines.
And how did you feel about traditional living arrangements where the mother might see more of the children, for example?
For me, one of the essential things that I wanted was shared custody. I felt very strongly that I wanted to have an important role to play in the children's lives. And for me, that meant 50-50. Because I wasn't really apportioning blame to either of us. We'd just gone that way.
Were there third parties involved in either of these splits?
No.
No?
No. You think there was?
Billy moved on quite quickly.
I did. I repartnered very quickly.
How quickly?
Within weeks.
OK. And did that contribute to how angry you were at the time, Elisa?
Absolutely. I think even when Billy first spoke to me about separating, it was sad, but I could understand that we got to that point. But when I learnt that there was somebody else in the picture, that was really, really hard to pill to swallow.
Jeremy, in Melbourne, you're there with your ex-wife Sue and your son Jules. You'd been married to Sue for 10 years when your marriage ended. Why did it end?
When I came out and basically told Sue that I was gay. You can imagine that obviously meant a fairly serious discussion about where that relationship went.
How did you tell her?
I think I just probably blurted it out, probably very clumsily.
Sue, what was that like for you?
Well, at that point in time, I was aware that something was wrong. And Jeremy actually went out the night beforehand and said, I have to tell you something really important tomorrow. So off he went and he didn't come home. And, of course, I'm thinking, oh, God, what's happened to him? You know, I was ringing up hospitals. And then he did. He came home and said, this is what I have to tell you. And I said, for goodness sake, just get it off your chest. I need to know because I know something's not right. So, of course, he told me. And, yeah, I was devastated. Mm. Absolutely.
How would you describe the marriage?
Yeah, I think we actually had a really good marriage. Jeremy and I had always been very, very close friends, and we really enjoyed each other's company.
So were you both clear on the fact that the marriage had to end?
interestingly enough, it was almost 2 years before we officially ended it. We kept thinking, surely we don't have to go down this path.
We tried counselling,
we tried everything, because the fact was we loved each other. We loved our family, we loved our relationship. It was New Year's Day, 1999, we went for a walk and said, it has to finish now because both of us have to go forward. It's obviously over. However much we love each other, we can't keep doing what we're doing. It's just not working.
Your son Jules was 6 years old when this happened. How did you explain it to him?
Oh, wow, I can still actually really remember. It was in the lounge room on the carpet and Sue actually said, you have to tell him. I can't tell him. You have to tell him. And, I mean, you can imagine, it was a conversation I just did not want to have. And before I even said anything, Julian just turned around and went, you're going to go, aren't you? You're going. Because, you know, I think we underestimate how much kids pick up on an atmosphere or sense that something's wrong.
Do you remember that conversation that your dad had with you?
Absolutely, I do. I can still point out the point in the carpet in the lounge room we sat down. It was, one of the most troubling things I think I have and will ever hear in my life, tell the truth.
Do you remember how you reacted, Jules?
I was deeply confused. How are you meant to comprehend what it means that your dad's gay? How do you know that? All you see is one of your parents leaving and your parents breaking up and you don't know why.
At that early stage, Jeremy and Sue, how did you think this was all likely to unfold in the long term?
Look, I would have to say I was genuinely concerned that was going to be the end of the friendship that I had with Sue. Sue, understandably, was pretty angry. We'd had this relationship for over 10 years, and to suddenly turn around and say, look, it's not going to continue, personally, I found that pretty devastating.
For me, there wasn't as much anger, because with Jeremy, it was a feeling of you can't help what you are. You're not doing this on purpose. It was an anger about the way that things are just had to work out and the way that things had to progress. But it was the biggest feeling about all of that was just this incredible sense of sadness and loss.
Yeah, yeah. Definitely.
It was just
absolutely
enormous sense of sadness. I mean, every time that, you know, after we separated and you used to come round with Julian and drop him off and stuff, Jeremy and I would just be in tears because
it was awful.
We were so sad about what had happened.
And Jules, how did you think things might unfold as a little kid? Were you thinking at all about what your future might look like?
That's a very big question there, Jenny. Before Mum and Dad broke up, I quite frankly wanted to be David Bowie, and afterwards I still did. but I definitely changed after it happened. I kind of lost the plot a bit. I became a much more anxious, much more emotionally, shall we say, demanding kid to myself and to others. And definitely it set me on a bit of a different path, I would say. I think I would have turned out very differently if things had just stayed the same way.
You'd had a dig at Fiona about a bottle of wine and the cost of it, and I thought that was petty. And so we had a bit of an altercation in the backyard. And
what is a bit of an altercation?
Well, we didn't come to fisticuffs, it got close.
Only because I stood in the middle of it.
Jeremy, once you and Sue decided to separate, how did you go about separating?
Well, we were very clear that we weren't going to involve any lawyers. We didn't want it to be any kind of an acrimonious end to it. I wanted 50-50. My relationship with Julian was and still is very important. And Sue was very, very open to that. I mean, very obviously, we spoke a lot about what we felt the best thing that we could do for Jules. And what we decided was stability. The same house, the same furniture.
Same school.
I mean, it sounds crazy. There was joint furniture that had been my mum's. I didn't want to take it because I wanted Julian to feel that nothing really at home had changed.
And you moved down the road and had 1 week on, 1 week off for a while, is that right?
So I was literally a 15-minute walk away. And yes, at first we did weekends.
The original outline was really annoying.
But at that age, you were okay with that?
Yeah, when I was at that age, it was okay. Yeah. But I mean, like, pack your bags on the Wednesday, you go around then you're back. It's just like, well, you get involved. It wasn't fun. But when we did week on, week off, it was very much easier for me to kind of settle in and find my roots at both houses.
Sue, what was it like for you?
I always felt Jeremy was a wonderful dad. And so it was really important to me, despite anything I felt and, you know, hurt or whatever, it was important to maintain that relationship between Jeremy and Julian. That was the most important thing.
Mum and Dad's only ever prioritised me with it, and they made sure that I wasn't negatively affected by what was going on. And I'm really grateful for that.
Mm. Well, thanks, Jules.
That's all right. It's all right. You're both not bad.
Sue, you mentioned earlier the anger that you felt initially. How did you deal with that anger and you know, the feelings that you had as the person who had to process this and come to terms with it?
I went and personally got counselling because I think that really helped. And there were a couple of times where Jeremy and I sat in the parklands and I just yelled and said, how could you do this to me? I didn't really, it was kind of being angry without being angry. I know it sounds weird, but it was like I had to get something out. But it wasn't really directed at Jeremy.
When did your relationship start to improve?
I would say we probably had about 3 or 4 years. I changed my profession from doing something I wasn't enjoying. I became a bit braver. I went on my first overseas trip to Japan by myself in 2002, came home and thought, wow, the world's a really big place. And also, the funny thing was, I really wanted to tell Jeremy about what Japan was like. So when he got back, it was great. We hung out and had coffee. And I told him all about it. It was really exciting. And I suddenly thought, nah, I've kind of moved on. I feel better in myself. I feel brave in myself again. I feel like I can take risks. I can do things. It just changed. And I also realised at the time that, you know, the great funny things that we still, you know, we liked about each other in the beginning and had always liked about each other were still there. But it was just in a different form. It was a different sort of relationship.
I remember.
And that was okay.
I remember when that happened, it was really interesting because it was like suddenly the hurt, the uncertainty, the frustration, it was like suddenly we were all just like,
let it go.
This doesn't matter. This doesn't matter. This was a blip. And then after that, we just revelled in our existence of being a bunch of dags together.
Yeah, we did.
Which we do very well, if I may say.
Sally, you split from your husband Cliff 8 years ago after 19 years together. Why?
I think we very much grew apart. I felt maybe I was gearing towards a different future. Cliff was very, very dedicated to his work, would be an understatement. And I'd gone part-time, focused on the children. You know, at that stage, we had a 3 and an 8-year-old.
And Cliff, how did you react when Sally ended the relationship?
Oh, well, it was a wee bit annoyed at first. It's never nice to be rejected, I guess. But eventually, I actually think she did a great thing. It was a good idea, ultimately.
It was, wasn't
it? It took me a little while longer to realise, maybe, but not that much, really.
And did one of you move out straight away?
No.
No. I'm not sure whether he got advice or whatever, but he was absolutely determined not to move out. He, I think, initially might have been worried that I wasn't going to ask for what was fair, which I could never understand because I'm a very fair and logical person.
He's shaking his head here.
No.
Wasn't it?
No. I just... no, not at all. I just thought maybe this could work, sharing the same house.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
And it was just easier to... while you're both getting money into the same pot to stay in the same place. And then when the finances got sorted, and I think they got sorted very well, then I could move out because I had cash in my pocket that was mine. So
how long did this last? How long were you living together?
Too long. Yeah.
It was about 10 months.
And what was that like, Ralph? Do you remember that?
I remember him sleeping in the front bedroom. At this point in time, I actually didn't realise that they were separating. I just thought they were sleeping in other beds. I just thought it was a part of a... I was, 8 years old. I just thought it was, a relationship thing.
And Rex, you were only three, so
yeah,
you didn't...
don't remember anything of it.
So how were you getting on at this stage under the same roof?
I don't think it was pretty. It wasn't pleasant. It was...
We didn't yell and scream at each other.
I would suggest we simply did not talk.
Yeah.
But how were you communicating if there was no talking?
If we had to, we'd talk.
So we could always talk about the boys, always. Just everything else. And when the finances, you probably fair to say, shut down, didn't do a lot of talking. So my father got involved and helped manage how we split, and he became a bit of an intermediary, didn't he?
Well, I negotiated it with him, yeah.
Yeah, okay, right.
So how did you deal with one another during this time? Because I know, Sally, you would write some angry emails and then you...
Yeah, so we exchanged a few angry emails for a while, and I don't know if you know this, but I had a brother that was also divorced and he gave me a lot of advice. And
yeah, he fair enough.
And I actually sent a few of the emails of what I wanted to reply to Cliff, and then he would actually take all the anger out of it and send it back to me. And I'd go, no, but I'm really angry, I want to say these things. And my brother Nick would go, no, you don't want to say these things, just say what needs to be said. And so I would
say... So he edited your emails
totally.
Effectively?
Really?
Yeah.
You didn't know that, Cliff?
No, I didn't have a clue. I think it's quite clever.
Yeah. So you kept it civil, yep. But there was a lot of anger
yep.
there.
Yep.
How did you negotiate the parenting once you, you know, started moving on and moving out of the house?
We typed out a parenting agreement.
Oh, that's right, you yeah. did. That's right. This Cliff got this full-on parenting agreement, which I suspect he got from America, which wrote...
I didn't actually work it out myself for the most part.
The one that was
where did you get it from,
long?
Cliff? What was the parenting agreement?
Oh, I might have Googled. It was...
See?
Googled a parenting agreement. OK.
You can amazing what you can find. it was
what
how
was we, it? Tell us what it was.
It was how we would... how often we would have the kids... how we would, where they would go for a school, I think that was in it as well, and we never resolved that one. How we treated the kids, how we communicated.
And how did you react to the agreement, Sally?
Originally, I was really angry.
Oh, really?
Well, it said stupid things like, I will not feed my child McDonald's. I never feed the boys McDonald's, and I was so cross. I think it was over the top, but I think, to be fair to Cliff, I had the boys more, and so this gave him a sense of security to know that things were locked down. But I think it would be fair to say that once we got this parenting agreement, I never looked at it again.
No, neither did I, actually.
Elisa, you and Billy, I mentioned earlier, had kids when you separated. Your daughter, Elisa, who was 7, I think, when it happened.
Yep.
And a son that you'd had together who was 2. Did you agree on custody initially?
No, we didn't. With Calvin, we went to the lawyer and we couldn't come up with it. And I remember the lawyer writing down all these scenarios so that we could make an agreement. And in the end, we agreed on 5 days a fortnight.
And what about your daughter?
So she visited Billy a couple of times and stayed with him when Calvin went, but ended up, after she probably saw just how much I was going through, decided to stay with me.
We had a phone conversation where Elisa was quite angry, and then she put her daughter on the phone, and her daughter parroted back a lot of the anger that her mum had and was...
I didn't put her on the phone. She took the phone from me.
That phone conversation I do remember, because that's one thing that, through my preparation, I didn't expect, so I was hurt a little bit by that. Because that was sort of ended the relationship I had with your daughter for a while. Mm.
Yeah.
And it's never been the same as it was.
No.
I found that difficult. As far as custody, I wanted more with Calvin, and we did work towards getting more.
Yeah.
Michael, when you and your wife, Fiona, were working out how you were going to separate, your sister made a suggestion. What was that suggestion?
Well, she said, why don't you treat the family home as the children's home? And so have the children stay there full time, and Fiona and I oscillate in and out on some sort of designated basis, whether it be weekly or fortnightly or whatever.
Mm. And how did you react to the idea?
when she first suggested it, I just went, yes, that'll work. I can actually sell that to Fiona. I reckon I can do that.
And Fiona, how did you react to this
Oh,
idea?
I thought it was a fantastic idea. It just ticked all the boxes. The kids could stay in their own home with their own bedrooms and their own things around them. And we were the ones, we were equally inconvenienced. And it worked really well. Yeah, it was no trouble selling it to me.
So how did it work? One of you would have the kids for a week, say.
Yep.
Where would the other one go?
Well, a traditional thing, if you're going to have people living separately, you're still having to run two households. Now, the idea of running two substantial households was financially beyond us, but we thought, well, we might be able to manage with a studio apartment somewhere, and we just treat the studio apartment as a hotel room. Hmm. And that's how we managed it.
So the kids stayed in the house. You and Fiona had alternate weeks there and alternate weeks at your shared apartment. What were the ground rules that you set down about the shared apartment that the two of you were now swapping out between one another?
There wasn't so many ground rules about the shared apartment other than, you know, treat it with respect insofar as I wanted to make sure that it was as clean for Fiona when she entered it as it was for me.
Did you put your own stuff in there? I mean, I'm really interested in the little details here.
We went and bought a couch together.
We bought those sorts of items, yeah. We agreed on the couch together. Okay. Right. And there would have been the odd little ornaments and things around
but
the place.
You bought a new bed, but you still shared the same bed home as well.
You were still coming back to the family home to sleep in the old marital
That's
bed.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Now, the obvious question is, where did any new partners fit in to this arrangement?
Right. They didn't for a long time.
One of the rules was that any new partners, there was no sleepovers in the family home, but you could do whatever you wanted to do in the apartment, but just leave it clean when they get back, sort of thing.
At least change the sheets.
We did all of that.
But as I said, there was one part was the respect part of making sure it was as... we treat it like a hotel room.
I'm going to get back onto new partners in a moment, but I just want to ask the three of you how you felt about this arrangement as it started playing out. Madeline?
Well, as it started playing out, I think there were definitely times where we would look at each other and go, wait, is it Mum's week or Dad's week this week? And because it ended up being just quite seamless and actually ended up being quite meshed. It was really like anyone's game.
Why do you think, you know, it was relatively seamless? I mean, going off shopping for couches when you've just divorced someone is a bit of a weird thing to do for most people in that situation.
Yeah,
Why do you think you were able to do it?
I think there was mutual respect between us. I think that we ended the marriage before we destroyed the friendship, so we were still friends. We still respected each other and we were working for the children. That was our main priority.
Mm. How long did you do this for?
Close to 7 years.
I
don't know what you did, but I basically lived out of a suitcase. I thought I couldn't be bothered putting things away for a week, so I literally lived out of a suitcase.
Did you ever go snooping?
Nope.
No.
Not once.
No, we never played that.
And I guess because...
I guess Elisa, you would have gone
snooping. I would have gone snooping. I guess because we were living in the studio apartment every second week, there was no point. Like, it was just... We sort of knew how each other's were living.
Mm. How did you keep it going for 7 years?
Well, the focus was the children, and specifically Madeline.
Who was the youngest and we needed to get through school.
And we just had decided that we wanted stability for her at being at high school. And we'd worked out that it was working because originally we started to rent, but once we'd got through the first period of renting, then after a year I said to Fiona, is this working for you? And she said, yep. And I said, great, I don't want to rent anymore, let's buy.
So a lot of trust here.
Yeah.
Where did new partners fit in to this whole setup?
Oh, it was 18 months, 15 months down the track before I re-partnered.
with Murray mm-hmm. over here. Yep. And Murray, how did it work for you?
It worked fine. I'm very family orientated. I don't have children of my own, so that wasn't a problem for the three children here. I didn't have an ex-wife, that sort of Fiona. And I could see what was going on.
You were the perfect partner.
He was.
I was handy around the house. And I could, yeah, and I could see what was going on, and I really bought it too. I thought it was a great story. They're great children. I could see that Michael and Fiona were good friends. And Fiona was a bit perplexed at how quickly I sort of easily I went along with it. And for six of those 7 years, I was living with Fiona those weeks that she was at the hotel or the unit. And I was moving and I was living out of a washing basket. I just had everything in that.
I'm going to get down to the nitty gritty here. Was it weird sleeping in the same bed as your partner's ex every other week?
No, it was like a motel. He was gone by the time we arrived, and we were the people who moved in the next day. It was just like that.
And you had a conversation with Michael about your own ground rules, the rules that you were going to abide by in this situation. What were they?
We went and had a coffee together and I said, Michael, I won't sleep in the matrimonial home. He said, thank you. I said, I won't discipline your children. He said, thank you. But I will back Fiona up if she needs it. The other thing I said to him was, no matter what happens, I'm not replacing their father.
And Michael, did you have a new partner during this time?
Yes, and I actually partnered up quicker than Fiona did. And there was never any conflict about it. We understood that we had separate lives to some degree, and it worked for us. Mm-hmm. And there wasn't any... there was never any talk about living permanently together.
Mm. And are you still together?
Yeah.
Sue, what was it like for you dealing with Jeremy's new partner when he had a new partner?
Look, it was difficult at first because I suppose as a mother I thought, well, this other person's coming to Julian's life and I don't really know him. But at the same time, I had to trust Jeremy because I knew Jeremy was not the sort of person that would put his child in any sort of difficult situation. And I suppose I trusted his judgment.
And what about you, Jeremy, when Sue had a new partner? How did you react?
There was a sense of, oh, okay, I've been replaced. But again, I knew Sue well enough and respected Sue well enough to know that really I had no right but to be supportive and positive about it, which I did try to be, and I think I did.
Of course you did, yeah.
How did your partners react to you being such good friends?
That was interesting.
Thank you, Jules.
Well, look, can I just say, my partner wasn't really relevant because I say that, I don't mean that in that sort of disparaging way, but he wasn't on the scene a lot and it didn't really matter after a while and I got well and truly sick of him. So, you know.
He was an interesting fella.
Yeah, but we'll leave it at that.
And Jeremy, what about your partner? How did he react to your friendship with Sue?
Look, I'd love to keep the fairy tale ending going, but unfortunately, pardon the pun, but unfortunately, I think he felt quite threatened, which I could never, ever understand.
Michael, you found a few things difficult early on. I mean, we don't want this to all just be, you know, rosy picture all the way. And they were to do with Murray's role in your family. What sort of things caused a bit of conflict between the two of you?
The main element of conflict that arose was we used to go on family holidays down the coast. And Fiona was quite keen to have Murray come along one particular year relatively early on. And I just wasn't comfortable with it. It was just, it was too early. It was maybe feeling like I was being usurped as the father as well. And I struggled with it and I just felt I needed the time. And it did lead to a conflict.
An altercation.
An altercation.
There was an altercation. What happened?
I don't remember it being about that issue, but No, that altercation was about something else for me. You'd had a dig at Fiona about a bottle of wine and the cost of it, and I thought that was petty. And so I thought, well, I'm going to have a dig back at him about something. And so we had a bit of an altercation in the backyard. And
what is a bit of an altercation?
Well, no, we didn't come to fisticuffs. It got close.
Only because I stood in the middle of you.
Yeah. So Michael was cutting the hedge at the time, and I can remember he just got through the secateurs down and hit the concrete, and luckily they bounced away from anyone. And I stood up and went, right, it's on. And and he came towards me and I came towards him, and then Fiona just got between us, and that was it. And that was the only time that we ever really came to even close to arguing or about something. I just felt there had to be a reset. I just felt like I needed Michael to understand that I was now Fiona's partner and I would stand up for her if in those little moments and those sort of things.
Billy, after you divorced Elisa, you said you repartnered very quickly. How quickly?
Within a couple of weeks.
And what was that like for you, Elisa?
It was really tough because I think that I fixated on the fact that Billy left me for someone else. So it was only years later that I've been able to look at our relationship and see that there was actually something wrong with our relationship, regardless of whether there was someone in the picture or not.
And were you in a new relationship at the time?
No. Mm.
Billy, Elise has spoken about some of the things that she did, you know, when you were angry with one another. What about you? What sort of things did you do to get under her skin?
So, again, the vision of hindsight, not necessarily proud of, but I'm not one to yell and scream. I'm not one to get all emotional and carry on. But I used my new relationship as a weapon. So I would allow her to write in the diary occasionally because I knew it would really get to Elisa.
Your new partner?
My new partner at the time, yeah. And it's not something I'm proud of, but at the time it was just I didn't want to react to Elisa's anger because that would just, you know, explode and cause all conflict for my son. So my petty revenge, and it is petty, is I'd let my partner write in the diary.
So you're getting under one another's skin for years. Mm. When did things start to change?
Probably when that partner left the scene.
That'll help.
To be honest, I think our relationship has had ebbs and flows depending on partners in our life.
Billy?
Like, the separation, I think, was for the best. I think where we both are now in our life is fantastic. I think we're both quite happy. So I wouldn't want to change a lot of what happened, but personally, I'd love to be able to take back some of those little petty, deliberate actions that were for no reason other than just to try to get under your skin.
And how have you got to the point where you can see that?
I've grown up. That's basically the gist of it. It's
we were only 25 when we separated. Yeah. So
and emotionally, I was about six.
And about a year ago, I went to a conference and one of the things that we explored there were maybe someone that we had been blaming our whole lives for setting us back in life. And the first person I thought of was Billy. And I rang him and I said, I'm asking for forgiveness because I've been blaming you for all these years that you weren't even aware of and it wasn't your fault. And he said, I can't forgive you. He said, you've got nothing to be sorry for. And it was at that stage that I think, I mean, we'd been friends for years, but I think there's been levels of a relief and mutual respect that has been built over time, which is something that I suppose the other couples had been able to build in their relationship. And we've just been able to build it outside our relationship, which is fantastic.
Jeremy and Sue, do either of you have partners now?
Oh, no. God, no.
These two gave up love years ago.
So we're here today because I'm getting married here next Saturday and we wanted to have a bit of a walkthrough, make sure we knew where we were going, that three of us would fit down the aisle together. I definitely think that if two parents haven't split amicably, it can put a lot of tension on an already stressful event like a wedding. I feel very, very lucky that I'm not in that kind of position.
I always envisioned my dad walking me down the aisle when I pictured my wedding, but my mum made it really clear that that is something that she really wanted and valued.
I'm feeling very proud that the two of us can walk Emma down the aisle together.
Oh, Emma, it's lovely.
Yeah. They're sitting together on the table and there's no kind of awkwardness or tension or anything between my two parents.
We've maintained very good relations.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we all get together. We're one big happy family. Yeah. You know.
Here. Right here.
I know of at least two or three couples where the parents barely can be in the same room as each other. So those seating plans and the whole days is, you know, masked with a lot of tension. And I think it's very sad that if that has to be the case.
Even if life's path hasn't quite gone down the way that you originally envisaged, that you can actually punch through it and maybe focus on the bigger picture a little bit and don't make it all about us necessarily.
Front on.
There we go.
Okay.
I feel incredibly grateful for both of my parents being on really good terms, not only in an event like this, but every day.
Emma, your wedding is next weekend.
Yes, it is.
What have you learnt about marriage from your parents?
Look, I think I've learnt that underneath a strong romantic relationship is a really good friendship. And I think that, you know, my parents have shown us that if the romantic part of the relationship is to break down, the friendship part doesn't have to.
Fiona, how would you describe your relationship with Michael now?
Oh, I think we're really good friends. I don't think you would disagree with
no,
that.
No,
I mean,
no.
We work together every day.
So you work in a business together?
Yes, we have a business together.
Just.
Are you still financially linked?
Not, well...
Yes.
Well, yes, we have our super fund together, which Michael runs. I pretty much let him do whatever he wants to do.
But I keep you informed all the time.
Absolutely, you keep me informed.
And Murray, what's all of that like for you as Fiona's husband?
Yeah, I mean, Michael's a great guy. He's a terrific father. He treats Fiona well. They work together. There's no problem there. We trust him implicitly.
Also, Murray and Dad get along very well as well. Like, they went to a Led Zeppelin concert together. I think Dad was like, oh, I really want to go to this concert. I have no one to go with. And Mum was like, oh, Murray will go with you. So they went and had a boys' date night together. Like, it, yeah.
What's that like for you?
Oh, it's a bit ridiculous. I mean, I mean, it's lovely. Like, it's so nice, but it I think Mum was bizarre. A bit like, oh, this is a bit overboard, but...
We'll go out to dinner and these guys will sit up the other end and, talk and leave me.
But we prefer it that way well. Like,
Definitely. Yeah, yeah.
Sally, how would you sum up your relationship with Cliff 8 years after the split?
I'd say it's much more positive. I think our boys are much better boys, more balanced. Cliff and I are happy within ourselves. Running as single parents, we actually parent the boys better together. And I think it means that we can actually make sure we put the boys first every single time. And I think I'm a happier person today.
And what about you, Cliff?
Look, exactly the same. These two little blokes didn't ask to be born. So, you know, we had them. So we have a duty of care to give them the best upbringing and life that we can. So I think it's kind of easy. That makes it easy to get on because we know that's better for them.
And you two now spend 1 week at Mum's and 1 week at Dad's?
He's still the original plan. Weekends are set like second week and then every Wednesday he'll spend at his dad's.
OK, so how do those arrangements work for you kids?
They work pretty well for me. I can definitely speak on being put first.
And what about you, Rex?
So for me, it's technically just regular, but every now and then I do jiu-jitsu. So I'm technically with Dad. It takes a bit longer to go to his house from my school because it's a bit further away from my school. Uh-huh. So, like, other than that, it's completely fine. And the jiu-jitsu just makes it take, I guess, a bit longer.
How would you describe your parents' relationship now?
Oh, well, now, like, how I see it is, so they're just, like, different houses. So I reckon, like, they're still kind of mates. But, like, that's the only way I'd really describe
Ralph,
it.
Ralph, what do you reckon?
Yeah, they're just good mates. You wouldn't really tell that they've ever divorced if you just met up with them, because they're just good friends, you know?
Billy, what do you think was the key thing that got you from where you were to where you are now? And where are you now in your relationship?
It was definitely both our love for our son that was able to get us through the times when it was difficult. It's a lot easier now that, I don't know, we're both in good places in our life.
Have you both got new partners?
Yes.
Yeah, I don't live with my partner, but yeah, we both got new partners.
And has that made a difference?
I'd like to think not. Like, I'd like to think that Calvin's our link and it wouldn't matter what our other circumstances are, that we still have that bond that will always be like parents to a boy.
What advice would you two give other people about moving from angry to amicable?
A diary is fantastic.
No. I mean, I'm sure that we could have come up with another scenario. I think having a neutral party is really important. But, I mean, that doesn't stop the anger and the pain. I think it's... I think what I was seeking out from Billy in the initial stages was some empathy, for him to really validate and understand what I was going through. But it was easier for him to shut off. So for me, it would have been easier if Billy had been my friend while I was grieving for our relationship, but he couldn't be.
My advice would be to focus on your child, to understand that you are going to have a relationship. You're stuck with that relationship.
I'm stuck with him for life now. But we are really good friends. We're going to each... I went to Billy's 40th last year. He's coming to my 40th this year.
Sue, where are you and Jeremy living now?
we share the house. We're back living in the same house. Yes.
And I'm back here too, as well.
Back here. So we're all back under the same roof.
How did it get to that point?
How did you
arrive there?
Well, you moved back to Adelaide for a period of time.
A few years. It was a business thing.
Yeah.
And then when that finished, the kind of decision was I wanted to move back to Melbourne. And Sue, because, I mean, obviously we'd kept in contact and we're friends. And Sue was the one that said, well, why don't you think about moving back? Why don't you move here? And I know... This might sound really crazy, but at that stage it was the most logical thing that anyone had actually ever said to me. And I went, yeah, great, that'd be fantastic. And may I also say that the bizarre thing, but the positive thing, was for Jules, speaking on your behalf, for Jules, it was the first time in his memory that Sue and I had actually been back together under the same roof.
Yeah, all I kept saying to Mum and Dad was just going up to them and just going, just seeing them both making coffee in the morning, kind of standing there going, yeah, I haven't got used to this one yet.
And, you know, we used to joke when we were married, the ideal marriage was to have two wings and meet in the middle. Well, funnily enough, that's how we've ended up. We have got two wings and we've ended up in the middle. But Jeremy and I just, you know, we still have the same sort of goals in life. We share lots of ideas and things. So it's just worked out really well that we share the house together.
Yeah, it's been it's really, been fantastic.
Really enjoyable.
I feel like it's a dirty shame thing to say that, yeah, it's really nice living with them. I never thought, I don't think there's many blokes in their late 20s going, yeah, I'm back with the parents for a bit. And, yeah, it's fantastic. Life throws you curveballs.
Certainly does. It certainly does.
Jeremy and Sue, do either of you have partners now?
Oh, no. God, no.
These two gave up love years ago.
No. We did give up on love, but we have, I suppose, got to that stage in our life. We're both now late 50s. Oh. You know, companionship is, for us now, for me personally, is way more important than all the rest of the stuff that goes with it, you know, the meeting someone. I'm very happy in myself. I've got a person that I really enjoy spending time with, but I enjoy spending time by myself. And I kind of, we've got all the benefits.
These two, if I may say so, have a thing, even, this sounds very strange to me, even with my own romantic relationships, is something that I aspire to, which is just a really beautiful, very lovely, solid foundation of friendship. And mum and dad really, you know, this sounds weird, but I don't want this to sound pessimistic to you both, but I really don't think you're going to find this vibe or anything close to anyone else. It's like those things are special. Yeah, they don't come along frequently, and they're not something you can just walk out and pick off a tree.
Yeah.
It comes from years of trust and years of work. It doesn't just happen.
It's just the common theme of respect.
Yes.
That's what I think I hear, and which I think is so wonderful. Respect and building on a friendship.
And looking
I think
after your child.
If you have those two things, your child is the focus, which everyone in that audience has been saying, I think you can work it through.
Yeah. I must say, like, something we spoke about this morning and we all agreed on, was that, yeah, there's no such thing as a good divorce. It's how you pick up the pieces and if you can pick up the pieces.
Mm. Yeah, afterwards.
Dan, what effect has your parents' divorce had on you?
I would say that I am closer with both of my parents now. I probably made more effort to spend the quality time with them on the weeks that I knew that they were in the house. And yeah, I'd say that overall, incredibly positive. I don't think that there's a single negative thing that's come out of it for me personally or the family either.
Emma?
I completely agree. I think that not only has our relationship with our parents gone much stronger, but I think as siblings as well, you know, we lent on each other a lot, and I think that's developed our lovely friendships as well.
Yeah. And Madeline, finally you. What do you think of your parents' divorce?
Oh, yeah. It doesn't feel like it's had that much of an effect. I think our parents separating was the best thing that happened for our family.
Thank you so much for coming here tonight and for talking about these things. All of you, thank you very much. It has been great to talk. That is all we have time for here, but let's keep the conversation going online. And you can, of course, watch heaps of past episodes of Insight at SBS On Demand. Thanks so much for watching. Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Well done.